Let's start with Jackal, the AOV, but the system more broadly. Explain the technology to us.
Yeah, thank you, Ed. So Jackal is what we call an autonomous orbital vehicle designed to fly in close proximity safely to other satellites. It has its own onboard propulsion capability that's a chemical system and is equipped with 5 different cameras that allow us to maneuver safely and image other satellites at a high resolution, pretty much in any orbital lighting conditions, whether it's an eclipse or whether it's fully lit by the sun. It's designed at a cost point that allows these systems to be proliferated at a scale that's so far been unachievable by the defense industrial base that's been supporting the Space Force and the intelligence community to date.
So if I'm the U.S. government or I'm Space Force, how do I get access to Jackal? How do I use it? And what are the threats in orbit that I'm trying to gather data on?
Well, the Space Force is thinking about transacting with the private sector in a variety of ways. We ultimately want to transact with the DoD in a way that allows us to align incentives so the True Anomaly can assume some of the technical risk that allows us to target margins that are interesting to particularly defense investors for future rounds. The Space Force hasn't made it very, very clear what they intend to transact on a typical firm fixed price contract where we're delivering the satellite for commercial operations or for government operations. The Space Force is working on a strategy to date to think through that, and we hope to be part of the conversation there.
One partnership you do have is you're going to ride on SpaceX at some point next year on your first mission. What's that experience like working with SpaceX in the rideshare context to get out to orbit?
SpaceX has been an absolutely fantastic partner. You know, the reality is that SpaceX has provided launch at a cost where companies like True Anomaly can get ready access to space at a price point that doesn't break the bank. 10 years ago, a company like True Anomaly couldn't exist because an ecosystem of capabilities and infrastructure and subsystems didn't exist for True Anomaly to have access to a supply chain that really has been matured by low-cost launch.
We're working with SpaceX and indeed, well, the U.S. government. What is the U.S. government as an institution like to deal with?
That's a great question, Caroline. It's a complicated relationship. The DoD really has responded very positively to what True Anomaly is building. You know, this company was founded by 4 co-founders that spent 10 years each in the United States Space Force and the Air Force as space operations officers. We saw the transition of the DoD thinking about the space domain as a peacetime domain to thinking about it as a warfighting domain. And what we recognized is that that required a new defense industrial partner explicitly focused and purpose-built for thinking about protecting the infrastructure that is in space that we've spent hundreds of billions of dollars as the United States and allies fielding, and that really is the backbone of global commerce and intelligence. So they've responded very positively, and at the end of the day, it's incumbent on True Anomaly to demonstrate that we can actually build and fly safely the systems that we have designed.
And so really, this unnerving sort of future that you paint of war in space, is that what it ends up looking like? It's a protection of one's assets out there rather than it becoming some ultimate sort of war zone that immediately makes one kind of go to Hollywood in one's mind's eye, at least.
Yeah, science fiction is sort of a complicated set of imaginaries around this and isn't always useful. The truth is that our adversaries have spent the last 20 years building an arsenal of counter-space weapons designed to target and destroy satellites. And that puts the United States and its allies' ability to project power globally significantly at risk. And these weapons are really conventional weapons, everything from missiles that are designed to be launched from the surface of the Earth to satellites that are designed to attack other satellites. Nobody wants a conflict that extends into space. If we have to fight that conflict, it needs to be done in a way that ultimately doesn't generate debris that prevents the access to space for future generations. So we can't, in other words, have a Pyrrhic victory, what General Saltzman, who's the chief of space operations, calls a Pyrrhic victory. The ideal outcome is deterrence, where we have an infrastructure in the space domain, the ability to gather information about what our adversaries are doing, to hold them accountable so that we can hold them accountable on the public stage, understand the next generation of systems that need to be built, and ultimately deter.
Evan, this was a very oversubscribed round, $100 million Series B. I know you're yet to reach unicorn status, but what will you use the cash for? How do you grow this year?
And we're really focused on delivering against the contracts that we've signed to date. We've had pretty exceptional revenue and orders traction. We have some really exciting announcements that'll come out in the next couple of months around that. I'm focused on investing in the team and delivering the product and scaling production.